our speaker today needs no introduction.
All right. Thank you, Tulio. Okay, thank you for coming. So today I'll tell you something about a couple of joint papers, one with Michael Hall. It's the first one listed here, and the second new paper with Catherine Pfaff. So first about the motivation and somehow the original motivation for this work comes from classical problems or classical questions in Riemannian geometry and dynamical systems, which have to do with counting closed geodesics in various manifolds. So if M is a closed manifold of, let's say, strictly negative curvature, and for L, a number greater than or equal to zero, we count, we denote by N of L the number of closed geodesics of length at most L on M, then, so a classic result of Margulis from basically his dissertation, so late 1960s, early 1970s, gives a precise asymptotics for the number of closed geodesics of length at most L, and it's this quantity e to the hL divided by hL, where h is the volume entropy of the manifold, which is the same thing as the topological entropy of the geodesic flow. And tilde here means that the ratio of the right-hand side and the left-hand side goes to infinity as L goes to, goes to 1 as L goes to infinity. So, but the important thing is that the number of closed geodesics basically grows exponentially in L, in this very precise way. There is this correcting term. Now, for certain reasons, and since then there have been many subsequent generalizations, which are still continuing, of this result to various other contexts, to the context of manifolds, which are not closed, which don't necessarily have negative curvature, also to the context where you don't necessarily have a manifold, but let's say some kind of a group acting on a space with negative curvature type properties, so. And the result, which is of more immediate motivation for us, is a much more recent result of Eskin and Mirzakhani from 2011, who considered the moduli space of a hyperbolic surface. So here, sigma G is the closed oriented surface of genus at least G. And once again, for L greater than or equal to zero, N of L is going to be now the number of closed tight geodesics of lengths at most L in the moduli space, of this surface with respect to the tight metric. And so once again, so Eskin and Mirzakhani here, they give a formula for the number of closed geodesics of lengths at most L in the moduli space. And the formula looks very similar, at least superficially, to the formula of Margulis. So it's equivalent to e to hL divided by hL, where h is 6g minus g, where g is the genus of the surface. Yeah, exactly, for the technical flow in this case. I want to give a quick reformulation of this result, which is going to be more relevant for us, which is that when you look at a closed geodesic of length L in the moduli space, of this surface, then so this closed geodesic, it comes from a periodic geodesic up in tachymular space, and this periodic geodesic is uniquely determined by by a conjugacy class in the mapping class group of a pseudo-Anosov element, and the length of the period, so the length of this closed geodesic, is equal to the length of the period, of the of this lifted periodic geodesic in the technical space. And there is a precise formula for that period. It's equal to log lambda of phi, and where lambda is the dilatation or the stretch factor, of this pseudo-Anosov element, where so the stretch factor is what you remember from the original definition of pseudo-Anosovness. So pseudo-Anosov homeomorphism is the one where there is a nice representative, where there exist these two invariant measures that are preserved by homeomorphism. So invariant transverse measures, one which gets multiplied by lambda and another which gets divided by lambda, and it's that lambda. So, but this is the algebraic reformulation, of this Eskin and Mirzakhani result that I want to sort of keep in mind. We can think about this N of L as counting the number of mapping class group conjugacy classes of pseudo-Anosovs with log lambda phi less than or equal than L. You know, so that's exactly the same thing. And yeah, so that's what's written here. And as what as was noted here, you know, so I didn't write it, you know, on this slide, but I do want to say that both this result and the original result of Margulis and essentially all the intermediate results, they are proved by analyzing the dynamics of some kind of a flow, the geodesic flow in the case of the original result of Margulis, or the Teichmuller you know, flow in this case, or something very similar, you know, so in other contexts. And so I want to consider similar questions for the outer automorphism group of the free group, and we have to first sort of figure out how to ask, you know, similar questions. So what's the corresponding, you know, objects here, and how do we reformulate these questions? So first I want to replace the notion of pseudo-Anosov by something, and the most important analog of being pseudo-Anosov in the context of outer automorphisms of free groups is the notion of a fully reducible element. And the fully reducible element, you know, is one which doesn't have any periodic conjugacy classes of proper free factors, you know, in the free group. So this is here is you know, a formal definition. So an outer automorphism of a free group is called fully reducible if no positive power of it preserves the conjugacy class of a proper free factor A, you know, of the free group. You know, so by proper free factor, I mean some subgroup which fits in the free product decomposition of the free group where both A and B are non-trivial. So, and I'm not going to say why, but the notion of being fully reducible, you know, it provides the main sort of out of our counterpart of being pseudo-Anosov, and it plays a very important role in the study of free group automorphisms. And there is also the notion of dilatation of the stretch factor here, which one can even define for an arbitrary free group automorphism, not necessarily a fully reducible one. So let me give you one definition of it, even though later on I'll tell you another way of computing it, you know, which is much more concrete. You know, so here is a formal definition. Maybe it's not sort of very informative, you know. So if you take sort of, if you think about it like a random, so let's say we start with a fully reducible automorphism and we take a random conjugacy class here, which is a non-periodic with respect to phi. If you don't like this assumption, think about W just being a primitive element, an arbitrary primitive element in the free group. You can take that for computing this lambda. And then we also fix some free basis in the free group, that's X. And then we start iterating the automorphism on this element W, and we apply it n times, and then we compute the cyclically reduced lengths of the result, you know, with respect to X, and we extract n's root, and we see, you know, what the limit is. It turns out that the limit exists, you know, and not only that, this limit doesn't depend on W, it depends only on phi. It doesn't depend on W, it doesn't depend on X, so it's an abstract invariant of phi. It tells you the exponential growth rate of conjugacy classes, of sort of generic conjugacy classes when you iterate phi. And this is called the dilatation of the stretch factor. And this quantity is actually an invariant of the conjugacy class of phi in out of R. So it's an important dynamic invariant. And as we'll see in a little while, in practice for the so-called fully reducible automorphisms, there is a prescription how to compute it. It's computed as the Piron-Frobenius eigenvalue of the transition matrix of a train track representative of phi. So there is a very specific way of computing it, you know, because this is a definition of abstract, and there is a specific way of computing it. So I'll say more about this later. So remember, in the context of moduli space of a surface, and also in the original context of Margulis' theorem, so we had this theorem which said that basically the number of closed geodesics grows exponentially up to some kind of a factor that you have to divide by. You know, I'll not explain why you have to divide by this hL, but you have to. You know, and there was a very precise exponential formula. So it turns out that in this case, you get something very different. Even though the theory of OutFr is to a very large extent informed by and motivated by the study of mapping class groups, and a lot of phenomena are similar. So here we get something which is very different, namely that you get double exponential behavior. So our main result, this is the result with Catherine Pfaff, is that when the rank of the free group is at least 3, then by n of LR, we are going to denote the number of OutFr conjugacy classes of fully reducibles with log lambda phi less than or equal than L, then this number it grows double exponentially in L. So there are double exponential upper and lower bounds. So here A, B, and C are some constants bigger than 1, and E is the constant E, 2.71, whatever. This is the base of the natural logarithm. So we get some kind of really new qualitative behavior for the free group in terms of the number, in terms of this growth. I'll say more about some more geometric interpretation of which is more similar to the original situation of counting closed geodesics, so what this number actually counts. But for now, let me leave it at that. So let me also mention and I'll say something more about this later, but as I said, trying to log me off. Don't want to log off. One of the basic conjugacy class invariants, of an out automorphism is this number lambda of phi, and it's similar to to a curve, let's say, to a closed curve on a hyperbolic manifold, the length of this curve is the invariant of the conjugacy class, of a closed geodesic. The question is, is there maybe some easier way of proving this theorem by counting the number of distinct lambda of phi's that appear in this theorem? Because maybe, and that's what actually one usually expects in the geometric situation, in the case of, let's say, a surface or a manifold, at least a hyperbolic surface, the number of distinct lengths of closed geodesics of lengths less than or equal than L grows, roughly speaking, the actual distinct lengths, where you forget about multiplicities. You would expect that it grows roughly, well, maybe up to some kind of polynomial fudge factor, that you would expect that it grows the same way as the number of closed geodesics themselves. That's not what happens here. So here it turns out that one gets some kind of dramatic difference. There is no hope of proving this result by trying to count distinct lambda of distinct lambdas. It's a much easier fact, but nevertheless we do observe it along the way. So this is this theorem A prime, which says that if you just count the number of distinct lambda phi's, where phi is fully reducible with log lambda less than or equal than L, then this grows at most exponentially, so you get like a huge discrepancy here between counting conjugacy classes where you get double exponential behavior and counting the lengths of these things where you get exponential behavior. So this is also interesting. One can say, okay, strange, but what can we say about, is it possible to still produce some kind of results about exponential growth rates, some kind of exponential growth results for counting conjugacy classes of fully reducibles? And the answer is yes, but you have to take them from a ball. You have to take them from somewhere where, the size of the set is already exponentially bounded. So we have this companion result with Michael Hall. So I'll put it on the slide, and I'll not sort of unparse it. But it basically says that if you take this OutFr and you fix some finite generating set for OutFr, and you start looking at the ball B sub L in the Cayley graph of OutFr of radius L, and you only pick elements from there, And then it says that you know, the number of distinct conjugacy classes of fully reducibles whose log lambda is on the order of L, you know, this actually does grow exponentially, you know, so one can prove that, you know, so we produce some kind of a proof, you know, now I know, you know, a couple of different ways of proving this, you know, so, but don't know whether I'll get to proving this theorem. So this is actually easier, you know, at least using modern tools than the previous theorem. The previous theorem, theorem A, is a sort of a hard thing here. But nevertheless, you know, so that these are the results. So let me sort of mention just what the general difficulties. So just for you to keep in mind with this kind of results in the algebraic context, well, also in the geometric context, in trying to count conjugacy classes of things, you know, conjugacy classes of group elements or, you know, things like closed geodesics. You know, one thing to keep in mind, you know, especially for people coming from group theory, is that you know, who are used to thinking about growth, is that having a free subgroup like a rank 2 or a rank bigger than 1 inside of a group G, you know, which gives you a lower exponential bound on the growth of G, it doesn't really tell you anything about the growth of the number of distinct conjugate, you know, the number of conjugacy classes coming from a ball, because you know, this free group, you know, even if you know that there is this free group inside, you know, so the elements could be non-conjugate in a free group, but they could be conjugate in the ambient group G. So one has to kind of struggle with this phenomenon. And therefore, simply having a free group, you know, of rank 2 or of rank bigger than 1 inside G does not give you a handle on the, or does not give you any kind of a lower bound, you know, a priori speaking, on the growth of conjugacy classes. And there are also relatively few well understood, you know, conjugacy class invariants, even in geometric situations. And as we've seen in the theorem A prime, you know, the stage factor lambda of phi itself is A, difficult to compute, and it's not suitable for counting conjugacy classes, at least not in OutFr situation, because it produces the wrong answer. So our theorem A prime tells you that the number of distinct lambda phi's in the context that we are interested grows at most exponentially, while theorem A tells you that the number of closed geodesics actually grows doubly exponentially. So it somehow is the wrong thing. And there are some other invariants, you know, in out-of-R situation, which like the index of an out-automorphism or the index list, you know, which are also conjugacy invariants, but unfortunately they only assume finitely many values, you know, for the so they give like partition of the entire, you know, out of R into like finitely many pieces, so they're not suitable for counting either, you know, because there are sort of only finitely many possibilities, you know, so they give you some kind of stratification into finitely many strata, but that's it, you know, so. And finally, you know, so the very fact that theorem A actually is true tells you that you cannot apply standard flow results or results from symbolic dynamics here at all. Because whenever you can apply them, they would give you a different answer. They would give you some kind of exponential answer, you know. And the fact that we get double exponential answer tells you that something completely different is happening and you have to do something else, you know. So, so somehow the situation that we end up analyzing turns out to be highly non-classical, which I personally have not yet encountered, and I don't really know yet how to think about it properly. I mean, so we have a result, but we haven't really understood it yet in some sense, and I think it remains to be seen what it actually means, you know, so. Okay, so let me tell you something about at least theorem A. I don't know whether we'll get to theorem B. So, one, and the main sort of technical tool here is these train track representatives, you know, so train track representatives, they're some efficient representations of certain kind of automorphisms by graph maps, by efficient graph maps. So here, you know, we'll start with an automorphism, and a train track representative will be, so of phi is a graph map, you know, which will represent phi quote efficiently. So let me go through this. I'll give you some examples, but let me pass through this definition. So we have our free group, FR, we have this graph, gamma. I don't know what it looks like. So here is gamma. So this gamma is required to be a finite connected graph where every vertex has degree 3. So another piece of data here is that there has to be some sort of identification between, and this is an important piece of information, identification between, it's called the marking between this free group and the fundamental group of this graph. And over here, we have to have this map F, which is a homotopy equivalence of this graph. And it has to be an efficient. So first of all, this homotopy equivalence, it has to, quote, topologically represent phi. That is to say that at the level of fundamental groups, so if you think about what map F induces at the level of fundamental groups, then modulo this identification, it should be it should be equal to phi. So I'll write it like that. So it should be topologically representing phi. So which means that after you translate this map via this identification, back to FR, you get phi, right? And it should be an efficient graph map. So it should be a graph map. So it should send vertices to vertices and edges to edge paths. And it's efficient property. So the train track property itself, so this is the last line of this definition, says that for every n, when you iterate this graph map on an edge, the result always remains an immersed edge path, an edge path without backtracks. So somehow you avoid cancellations here at all, at least when you iterate this map on edges. So it's some kind of a way to partially eliminate cancellations, which are of course present in free groups. So when you deal at least with iterating the map on edges, and this train track, you can associate a transition matrix, non-negative integer matrix to it. So if m is the number of edges arcs, in this graph, so we can associate a matrix here where aij is the number of times that the path f of ej crosses over the edge ei in either positive or negative direction. So this is a matrix, and so by lambda of f, I'll denote the spectral radius of this matrix, the maximum of the absolute values of the eigenvalues of A. And if this matrix A of F is irreducible in the sense of Perron-Frobenius theory, that is to say, if for every empty ij there exists a power of the matrix where the entry in the position ij is strictly positive, then it is known that this lambda of F is actually an eigenvalue of A of F itself. And not only that, but in this case, it's a simple eigenvalue, and there exists a corresponding eigenvector whose entries are positive real numbers. So if the matrix F is irreducible, then this lambda of F is an eigenvalue called the Perron-Frobenius eigenvalue. So as I said, the train track map is irreducible if this matrix is irreducible. And combinatorially, this means that for any two edges EI, EJ, there exists a power such that F to the n of EI crosses over the edge EJ in either positive or negative direction. And so I'll give you sort of an example, and I'll then tell you what the point of it is in relation to computing lambda of an automorphism. So here is an automorphism of a free group on two generators A and B. Phi of A is equal to BA, phi of B is equal to A. And for the graph, I'll just use the rows. So our free group will be the free group on A and B. The graph will be this graph, A, B. This is going to be the graph gamma. So there is a natural identification here, you know, between f of a, b, and the fundamental group of this graph, which identifies a with this loop and b with this loop. So you can think about this phi as defining a map which takes the edge a and takes it to the path, b a, and takes the edge b and sends it to the loop a. You know, so that's the, that's the map f which I want to consider here. And so
is
if
in relation to the sort of abelianization of the map in some sense.
There is some weak relation, but here, remember, I'm counting in the transition matrix both occurrences backwards and forwards. So, I mean, it's a somewhat different thing. So it's not the same thing as abelianizing, because here, in this transition matrix, I'm counting sort of both negative and positive occurrences of EI and EJ. That's what the transition matrix records. So in this case, the transition matrix is this matrix, and here is the characteristic polynomial, and here are the two eigenvalues, and so this matrix is irreducible, and lambda of f is the golden ratio. So I think that we might have seen this in one of Tullio's talks. This matrix may be a transposition, something. And also, another theorem is that the train track map is expanding if for every edge e, the combinatorial length of this edge goes to infinity, when n goes to infinity, which is the case here. And so let me mention sort of a couple of critical facts, which are relevant to the previous discussion. So I didn't tell you, but not every automorphism in general can be represented by a train track map. But fully reducible automorphisms can be represented, and in fact, they can be represented by expanding and irreducible train track maps. So every fully reducible automorphism can be represented by a train track map, and those train track maps are necessarily expanding and irreducible, so the transition matrices are nice. And not only that, if you have an expanding and reducible train track representative of some phi, then this lambda of f, which is the spectral radius, of the transition matrix, or the same thing as the Perron-Frobenius eigenvalue, is equal to lambda of phi, which is the stretch vector, the algebraic stretch vector of phi, which I defined before in terms of the growth of conjugacy classes. So that's how you compute the lambda of phi in practice. So in particular for this automorphism, in this case, from the previous slide, lambda of phi, for this phi is equal to 1 plus square root of 5 over 2. All right, so that's what it says. So now I'm going to be very sketchy. I'm going to tell you very little, because this is a whole different topic. So in the context of OutFr, there is a counterpart for Teichmuller space, the so-called Kalor-Volkmann outer space. And Kalor-Volkmann outer space, which comes equipped with a nice OutFr action. And there is also some kind of an analog of Teichmuller metric and Teichmuller geodesics, here. I'll not tell you sort of very much about this, but so for those of you who actually remember what Teichmuller space is, so the Teichmuller space is it consists of marked hyperbolic structures on a topological surface, right? So points of outer space, they consist of marked metric graph structures, on the free group. So a point in outer space, it sort of looks like this. So you have some kind of identification between your free group and the fundamental group of a graph like that. And on this graph, you have additional data, which is that with every edge, there is an associated positive lengths. And this lengths are normalized in such a way that their sum is equal to 1. So this is some kind of a volume normalization requirement. So that's what individual points of outer space look like. So they're marked metric graphs. And it looks like individual points of outer space, they're actually much simpler objects than points in Teichmuller space, and it's true. But the way they're packaged together makes the object much sort of harder in some sense than the Tegmell space because you don't have the nice local structures here that are present in the various analytic structures that are present in the Tegmell space situation. Still, it turns out, so here is a picture. So in particular, the Tegmell space, you see, at least abstractly, it's a manifold. I mean, it's not a Riemannian manifold, it's a Finsler manifold, but abstractly, it's sort of a manifold, right? You know, so an outer space, it's not. It's a highly branched object. You know, so even in the case of rank two, it already kind of looks spiky. You know, so and if the rank of the free group is bigger than two, it already looks much worse than this. So in the case of rank two, it still looks kind of similar to the Tegmell space, you know, of a punctured torus or something. But the moment you get from away from rank two, it starts looking worse. And there is also some kind of a substitute here for Tegmell metric. You know, there is this asymmetric Lipschitz metric for which there are also geodesics. So it's a geodesic metric. I'll not try to explain to you what it is. And so similar to what we had, you know, in the Tegmell space situation where pseudo-Anosov elements, they had unique axis, geodesic. So every pseudo-Anosov element of the mapping class group. In the Tegmell space situation, you have this unique axis, you know, G where G is pseudo-Anosov. So in the case of outer space, there is still invariant geodesic axis for fully irreducibles, but in general they're highly not unique. You know, so I'll still draw it as a disk. You know, so and now phi is going to be fully irreducible. In and now somehow instead of in fact, I should probably be sort of drawing it as some kind of a branched object, you know. So, the so in general, you get some kind of a. Don't quite know how to draw it, but so the family of axes, you know, of phi. I mean, it is in general not unique, and not only that, it even though in some sense it looks some kind of a line, it actually has a fairly branched structure. It doesn't sit in a plane. It's some kind of a highly branched non-unique object. You know, so this is one of the sort of essential features of what happens. But it turns out that, okay, technology. This axis, they actually come, you know, from train track representatives. You know, they come, there are certain kind of periodic folding lines that are defined by, in outer space, that are defined by train track representatives of phi. And not only that, but in some sense, in a precise sense, every axis of phi comes from a train track. So the other way around. So it's an if and only if correspondence. You know, so every train track representative of phi, you know, comes from a periodic periodic geodesic, you know, and periodic geodesics, they come from train track representatives. So understanding periodic geodesics and understanding train track representatives is basically the same thing. So so there is recent work of Mosher and Pfaff, where they produced a particularly nice class of fully reducible automorphisms for which this entire collection of axes, you know, the entire collection of axes is what they called an axis bundle, consists of a unique line. You know, these are called lone axis fully reducibles. You know, so it turns out that they exist, and in fact there is some suspicion that at least in the sense of random walks or something, but you know, we are trying to prove this now, it's not yet known, is that this kind of behavior may be in some sense generic, but at the very least it's known now that they exist. And they also produce some sufficient conditions, you know, for verifying that a specific automorphism has this lone axis property. And this condition is given, you can verify starting from a train track representative of this automorphism. And there are sort of two components, two parts to verifying this low nexus property. One, you in some sense have to analyze the property of this lamination associated with this automorphism. More or less, you have to understand what happens with every edge under long-term iterations, and you have to sort of record. Combinatorially, it corresponds to recording the information about two edge subpaths, which occur inside iterates of edges. So it's a fairly simple combinatorial data, and then you have to arrange it into something called a Rousey graph, some kind of a graph, and understand the geometric property of this graph. So this is a fairly straightforward task. But the other part, in this criterion, the one which makes it hard, has to do with ruling out the existence of what's called periodic Nielsen paths. So these are paths in this graph, of a certain kind, with the property that, so these are paths in gamma with the property that for some positive power n, after the n of eta is homotopic to eta relative endpoints, it's some kind of fixed point condition, a complicated fixed point, a periodic condition, and in order to apply the criterion, one needs to prove that a specific train track does not have any of these periodic Nielsen paths, and that's the hard thing. That's usually the hardest problem in verifying this condition. So let me try to now. So I'll introduce a new the actual tool that we use in proving the main result, and then I'll tell you something about the proof of theorem A. I'll probably not get to theorem B. We'll see. So. For an outer automorphism, let's assume that the automorphism is fully reducible. By capital U of phi, we are going to denote the set of combinatorial types of its train track representatives on the rows, where basically we look at all possible train track representatives of this phi, where the underlying graph is a wedge of R circles, which it doesn't have to be in the original definition of a train track representative, but now I look only at those. And now I look at combinatorial types of this map, of these maps, forgetting, and I forget about the marking. So I look at sort of combinatorial types of unmarked train track representatives of this automorphism on the rows. So this is some kind of a finite set. And a priori, in fact, one can show that the cardinality of this, it's not immediately obvious what the cardinality of this set is, but it's finite and it's bounded by something double exponential in lambda of phi. So our key lemma says that if you start with something which is a low nexus fully reducible, one of these nice guys, then we get a much better bound, on the number of sort of combinatorial types of train track representatives of this on the row. So it's bounded by sort of the norm of F, where the norm of F is the, let's say, the sum of the lengths of edges, and somehow in this case, one needs to understand what happens in a single period, along this axis, so because after that, after this period, everything repeats, at least combinatorially speaking, the marking changes, but everything else repeats. And within this period, so we prove this lemma and get this bound. So now let me tell you how the actual proof of theorem A sort of proceeds. I'll explain it in the case of rank R equals 3. And I'll so the general case is similar. So let's say R is equal to 3, and our free group is the free group on A, B, and C. So now I'm going to start with a positive word W in B and C. Later on, it will be a random positive word. And we are going to define a map which you can also think of as an automorphism from the rows, you know, R3, which is the rows, you know, labeled where the petals are labeled by A, B, and C, where A goes to B, B goes to C, and C goes to A times W in B and C. So this is a very explicit construction, and one can check that in this case, you know, this is in fact, you know, it's a homotopy equivalence, so this defines an automorphism of this free group. And also because everything is positive here, this is a train track map. You iterate this on edges, there are no cancellations because everything is positive. And so the key step in the proof is so even though, I mean, I discussed this at some point with Paul, I mean, one might be able to use this GW on the nose using small cancellation arguments, but you don't know how to distinguish conjugacy classes of GWs themselves, or at least their out automorphisms. But instead, we do something else. So what we do is we find a correcting automorphism eta, which will be the same for all GWs. So a single positive map, you know, on these rows. And then we postcompose. We first apply this eta, and then we postcompose it with this GW to get a new train track map, you know, FW, which is also going to represent some automorphism, which is going to be denoted phi sub W. And this map eta is chosen in such a way that if W's were sufficiently long and sufficiently random as words in B and C, then this phi sub W will have the lone axis property. So it will have the right behavior in terms of the properties of this lamination, and it will have no periodic Nielsen pass. So that's sort of where the magic is hidden, and that's where the most difficult technical work, you know, is done. So for now, you just have to believe me that this can be done. So let's see what happens if this can be done. So what effect does it have on counting? You know, so now for L at least one, so the number of random positive words is roughly the same as the number of all positive words of, so the number of random positive words of e to the L in B and C is the same, roughly speaking, as the number of all positive words in B and C, the alphabet in two letters, so it's like 2 to the e to the L, right? And if you look here, you know, so the number of sort of these maps, you know, so if W is a word of length e to the L, so we get sort of roughly e to the L of distinct, combinatorially distinct maps. And even after we precompose them with this eta, well, this requires a little bit of an argument, but nevertheless, because eta is fixed, so we get roughly on the order of 2 to the e to the L distinct, combinatorially distinct maps on this, you know, on the rows, representing this fully reducibles phi sum double, phi sub W. And so what's the norm of this F sub W's? So the norm of G sub W is basically the maximum of the length of images of the edges, which is like, in this case, it's e to the L plus one. But even after we precompose it with this eta, it remains basically on the order of e to the L. You know, so the norm of all of these things is some, you know, constant times, bounded by some constant times e to the L, which now we can apply, you know, this key lemma, which says that for each of the automorphisms represented by this F sub W represents an actual out automorphism. So the size of this invariant is bounded by some, by where the norm of its train track representative, which is exponential in L, right? You know, and the size of this invariant, you know, so it gives us, so because remember this only, this depends only on the conjugacy class, you know, so of phi sub W. So in this 2 to the e to the L, you know, distinct train track maps, so what's the maximal multiplicity, what's the maximal chunk, you know, of this collection of train track map on the rows that can possibly represent, you know, this particular automorphism. So it's this many. it's this multiplicity. So that's what this lemma says. So it means that so when we look at the number of distinct conjugacy classes represented by this collection of distinct combinatorial distinct train track maps, so the maximal multiplicity for a single conjugacy class is given by this exponential quantity. The number of distinct combinatorial distinct sort of train track maps here is double exponential, and when you divide the double exponential by the single exponential, you still get something which is bounded below by a double exponential. You have to modify the base a little bit. And now when we look at the stretch factor of this thing, so some Perron-Frobenius argument tells you that it's basically L, for this train track maps, so F sub W that we constructed, lambda here is basically L. So here we've gotten doubly exponentially distinct, conjugacy classes of automorphisms, with log lambda less than or equal than L. So that's the construction. And the upper bound, in this theorem is obtained, by different by sort of a more direct Perron-Frobenius, counting argument, so I'm going to skip that. That's sort of in some sense easier. So that's what happens in theorem A. So I'm not sure that I have any time. I don't know whether I should tell you. Only five minutes left about theorem B. So theorem B is proved by completely different means using. As I said, by now I know like three different ways of proving the theorem B. So we use this trick using the theory of hyperbolically embedded subgroups. So I think there are probably only 4 minutes left. Let me just skip that, and I'll go to the last slide where I will. Instead, pose some questions. So for those of you who really want to know something about theorem B, you can look at the slides of this talk at my at my webpage. So let me throw in some questions here. So the first question is: how can we describe, in more precise terms, the asymptotics of this number of conjugacy classes, of fully reducibles with log lambda less than or equal than L. And now, so I'll first ask this question, and second, the other part of this question is, what does this question even mean? Because for a function which grows exponentially, so in L, there are sort of standard ways of trying to understand at least its first order asymptotics. You have this function depending on L, and you take log f of L divided by L, and you take lim sup or lim inf as L goes to infinity, and this is some kind of exponential growth rate. For a function which is double exponential, it's much sort of less clear as to, in fact, it seems that it has two entropies rather than one. But it's not completely clear what the question means, and it's not completely clear how one is supposed to analyze the asymptotics of a function which is double exponential. But the principle of the upper entropy, which sort of so if it's bigger than one, so for a function which is exactly equal to that, is this number b, or rather, okay, it's log of b. It's computed by this formula. So so this formula computes sort of log b. Our theorem sort of tells us that so we get some kind of lower bound for this thing which is greater than equal than one, I think. And the question is, does it depend on R, on the rank of the group? So we don't know. And so in this case, so it's not clear whether the actual limit exists. And it's not clear One can also try to fish out in some more correct way. I don't know how the base of the sort of the other entropy characteristic here, which is the base of exponent. I'm not quite sure how to sort of to extract it from the function, whether or not that thing depends on R. You know, so even in terms of understanding naively the asymptotics of this function, so there are some interesting questions. There are some other questions as to what it all means in terms of space of invariant measures, you know, on the set of all, let's say, periodic of all geodesics, you know, in outer space, you know, or all geodesics in the modular space of outer space, or what it all means in terms of trying to construct some kind of Sullivan-Patterson measures, you know, on the boundary of outer space, because when you try to do that, you usually need to normalize by something to do with the critical exponent. And here, so critical exponent is usually something which is controlled by this topological entropy or the volume entropy. And here we have this double exponential thing, so it's not completely clear what one should do instead of critical exponents. What do you even have to normalize by now if we want to try to construct an object like, you know, the Patterson-Sullivan, you know, measure on the boundary of outer space? So there are all sorts of questions that suddenly this sort of theorem indicates and brings up, you know, and there are similar questions, you know, about theorem B in terms of the correct scale, you know. So I think that, you know, basically, you know, this topic, it opens up a number of interesting avenues of further research. So I'll stop here. Thank you very much.